Thank you.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 2 p.m. Stay tuned next for About Health.
Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. Everyone feels stressed from time to time. A stressor may be a one-time or short-term occurrence, or it can be something that keeps happening over and over again. In this country, most people go at a fast pace, eat on the run, work long hours, and are sleep-deprived on a regular basis. Without taking time to tune in to what you're feeling and what your body needs, you may not realize that you're depleted on a regular basis, and you may not recognize how the pressures of life impact your health and your relationships. Some people get sick, irritable, anxious, and may become dependent on things like caffeine, pain pills, alcohol, or the internet. Many of the parents I work with know they are depleted, but can't seem to figure out how to have more joy and less overwhelm, since they're busy all the time taking care of others. I'm Nurse Rona, here twice a month to explore different concepts of health. Today, we'll discuss the unhealthy cycle of high stress and what the pressured pace of modern life does to your well-being. Joining me in studio is Peter Wright, a somatic psychotherapist in private practice in Berkeley and San Francisco, and a clinical supervisor for the Center for Somatic Psychotherapy in San Francisco. Peter is also a consultant to clinicians and social service agencies throughout the Bay Area. Many years of personal and professional studies with the founder of Formative Psychology, Stanley Kelman, has provided a primary frame for his work, and Peter has practiced the art of Aikido for over 20 years, a practice that informs his understanding of transition, growth, and relationships. Peter Wright, welcome to About Health.
Thank you, Rona. It's nice to be here.
Well, I want to start off with you by having you give us a brief overview of some of the terms I just used to introduce you. So the terms such as somatic therapy and formative psychology. Tell us a little bit. I know that soma in Greek is the word for body, so that much I know.
That's right. That's a good start. Well, somatic psychology fundamentally orients somebody to knowing themselves, knowing their emotions, knowing their thoughts as things that are generated by the body and the body process. So simply put, many people believe they have a body, but from a somatic psychotherapy point of view, you are your body. So how you interact with yourself physically, how you shape yourself, how you hold yourself, generates your experience.
Uh-huh. That's pretty deep. And really good, because I know from my own life, especially when I was working a lot and raising my kids, there were times when I felt really disassociated or disconnected to my body. And I think that's the kind of thing I'm interested in talking about.
Yeah, that's right. The more demands that we have and the more things that are challenging us for our attention, we have to divide ourselves. We have to focus outside, and then focusing inside becomes more and more difficult.
Yeah, good. And you use the term formative psychology, which is a term that I've heard, but I don't know a lot about. Tell us about that.
Formative psychology was created by Stanley Kelman, who is a pioneer in psychology from the early 40s. And basically what Stanley has done is taken evolutionary principles, really an organism in its environment, and has framed that as a way that people can participate with themselves. So if they take note of what's going on around them and take note of what's going on in them, they can actually participate in the shaping of their experience.
So taking note is always the first step.
Yeah. Noticing.
Observing.
Uh-huh. And then after observing, it's attending and participating. So really, from, again, this may be a deep orientation, but from a formative perspective, we are not simply receiving evolution. We are participants in evolution, so we can shape ourselves and our experience.
Good. I'd like to kind of go into that a little bit more as well. These are really interesting ideas. And the reason I wanted to talk with you today is because we do live in this fast-paced world, and people seem to me a little more frantic, more stressed, more overwhelmed than I remember, say, 10 years ago even. And I don't know whether that's just because I've slowed down a little and I can see things differently. So I want to know from you about the cycle of stress that you see, whether it's with clients or students or friends. And I'm also interested in hearing if you feel like things have gotten worse recently, because I know a lot of people feel their level of stress has gone up, especially since the election, since we hear so much on the news about climate change and all the terrorist attacks and all the things that are happening. Tell us your perspective on the cycle of stress.
We adapt remarkably. That's a hallmark of human beings, is our capacity to adapt. And in the last 10, 15 years in particular, the amount of information that's available and that is accessible to us, whether it's in our pocket or on our wrist or on the airwaves or on the internet, all these sources of information are constantly streaming and constantly challenging us for their attention. And over time, we respond. And as we respond to this information at a higher pace and more intense qualities and content of information, that becomes a practice. And so repeatedly, I mean, imagine how many times a day you look at your phone or how many times a day you look at, if you have a Fitbit or a watch that is talking to you in some fashion or another. And those practices over time constantly divert our attention to the outside, to the external. And with that practice over time, that's where we go, and that's what we attend to. And less we attend to the signals that our own bodies are generating for us.
Right. And so that's why things seem to me like people are a little more disconnected and more stressed, in part because we are not stopping and saying, oh, I need to go get some fresh air, because
right,
there's something else that's more seductive.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so not only are we attending outwards, but we're attending largely at the pace of our brains. And the pace of our brains selects particular kinds of information. It has us moving faster. It has us generating expectations that things happen at that pace. So a slower pace, the pace of your digestion, for example, takes a lot longer, and that gives a longer time frame, and so expectations change.
Yeah, and I think that stress over time feels normal. It begins to feel normal.
Either it begins to feel normal, or we begin not to feel it much at all, because that's not part of what we're attending to. So more of the focus is, did I get that thing done? Have I done enough in this time frame? Am I accomplishing all I hope to? So the other aspects of our life, the quality of our life, am I satisfied? Do I feel rested? Do I feel engaged?
Those connected with my partner.
Exactly. Those may diminish.
Right, because we also live in a society that I feel very strongly says, if you're busy, you're important. And if you're busy, in some way, you're more powerful. You know, like you'll say to someone, how are you doing? Oh, God, I'm so busy. I have so much to do. And that becomes like a badge of honor in some ways. I have a friend, Christine Carter, who wrote the book, The Sweet Spot. And she talks about that a lot. She realized in her own life, when she started getting sick a lot, that she, you know, people would say to her, how are you doing? Well, I'm so busy. And that became something to be proud of.
Absolutely.
And I think everyone listening could really think about that in their own life. How often do we say, oh, I'm so busy? And you may be busy, but there's some kind of way in which we think if we're not busy, we're not as worthwhile.
And busyness also includes, I go to yoga 5 times a week, or I'm doing these exercise classes, or I'm meditating, or I'm either one idea or concept of what the right thing to do is, without necessarily a kind of feedback with themselves. So what becomes important from a somatic or formative point of view is the participation. It's the exchange, it's the communication back and forth with oneself.
Don't let me forget that I need to ask you more about how do we do that. So we will get into that. I wanted to give out our phone number first.
Great.
Because it's like, okay, how do I listen? You know, how do I hear it? So you can join us if you'd like. My guest is Peter Wright. He's a somatic psychotherapist in the Bay Area. Our phone number here on About Health is 1-800-958-9008, 1-800-958-9008. You can call us and talk about your experience with high stress and how the impact of modern life affects you and what you do to stay in touch with your body and your needs. And Peter, you know, I know that stress can really affect our hormones, and we could start to have real negative effects on our body, including how we store fat more around our abdomen, for instance.
That's
how
right.
Our immune system could be out of whack. It slows down. Stress can slow down our thinking, can impact our brain. Maybe talk a little bit more about the impacts of stress.
You're naming some very important ones. And the effects of long-term stress. So maybe we could start by saying there are two kinds of stress. One is more short-term, or one might even feel crisis-oriented. And the effects of those are feeling agitated or headache, things of that nature. But the longer-term effects of stress, again, develop patterns, not only patterns of effects that we feel are happening to us, but patterns of behaviors that we generate. And some of those effects are fatigue, depression, cardiovascular problems or heart difficulties. A great resource for finding out more about the whole list of challenges related to long-term stress is Robert Sapolsky's book, Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers.
It's funny, I wrote that down on my notes to make sure and mention it. Let's see how we spell his name. It is Sapolsky.
That's right.
Robert. And Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers. And we do know that ulcers probably now are caused also by a bacteria.
Yes, but interestingly, many people have that bacteria, but only some people develop ulcers in relation to having that bacteria. So it is a matter of lifestyle and self-engagement and self-use.
Tell me more about what you like about his work.
One, he is a great writer in terms of simplicity and making it accessible to people. But also, he really makes the distinction between what people feel is happening to them and how they can participate in it. And that makes a big difference.
So what I remember, I went to a talk by him once, and what stands in my mind is that animals can be under threat and their cortisol levels go up. They're in fight and flight. They usually don't freeze, but sometimes they freeze. But, you know, they're in that state. The lion doesn't kill the zebra, kill someone else. And so then this zebra just goes off and starts acting normal again.
That's right. That's right. So stress for animals, most animals, is situational. But for people, I mean, this is our real complication of being humans. We have the gift of a cortex which allows us to participate in our own behavior. But at the same time, thinking about, anticipating, remembering challenges or moments of crisis means that we repeat those same things over and over again, whether or not it's useful.
Part of being human. Let's take a call now. We have Rodney from Oakland with us. Hi, Rodney. You're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Rona. How you doing? Nurse Rona, I'm sorry.
That's okay. Yeah, I'll take nurse. It's a much easier profession.
I heard that. I don't know if I believe you, but I hear you. I have one question. I'm a black guy from Oakland, and just looking at the news, I guess, over the past few years and recently, black folks are facing stress from technology and lifestyle and all that stuff, but they also are facing racism. Can you talk about that and how that adds to modern-day stress and modern life as well?
Great question, Rodney. Thank you for calling with that, because we know through all the research that racism causes stress, and then stress causes, you know, wreaks havoc on your body and your mind. And I remember recently when I went to a training, this is really interesting, I hope I get it right. The trainer was saying that they did a study, I think it was like in 2012, somewhere around there, where they had people taking a test. And they had an African-American woman sitting next to, say, a white woman. And the study had the white woman do subtle signs of possible racism, you know, not overt, more subtle. And that those subtle signs affected how well the African-American woman did on her test. She did much more poorly on the test when she felt like someone was, in a sense, criticizing, judging, expressing some form of racism towards the person. And so their grade wasn't as good. So I'm just using that as an example of something really subtle. You know, we see examples in the news all the time of the horror and the overt racism and the way in which I believe, not being African-American, but I believe from my friends and people I know, are on high alert because of the injustice in the system. But it can also be quite subtle. And I thought that was important for us to realize. But let me turn this over to you, Peter.
Sure. Thanks, Rona. Rodney, so how I'm listening to your question and relating it to general states of racism in the country and those environments is, while seeking to make changes in that, in a more social realm, a social fabric, what really makes a difference on a personal level is feeling the effects, as Rona is saying, recognizing that somebody's external cues is also creating an effect in you, which might be an increase in muscular tension. It might be happening in a specific location, in your jaw, in your chest, in your arms. And if you can recognize those, if you can recognize the changes and the shifts, then if you can engage them, increasing them first so that then you can decrease them, then you have something that is quite unique on a personal level, which is facing something that may feel insurmountable outside you, but you can make an influence inside yourself while you're hoping or while you're acting toward making the changes in the larger world. So really a source of possible optimism is being able to influence yourself. More so than saying, well, what I see and what I hear, I just pretend isn't happening. That's not what I'm suggesting at all. But rather, how is it affecting me? And how can I begin to take charge of that effect while I'm engaging and trying to make a change in the larger world?
Have you had that experience, Rodney?
Well, absolutely. So I guess the trick would be calm down, focus on where I am and what I'm feeling, and then make a rational decision about what steps to take next.
Yes, absolutely.
Am I hearing that correctly?
Yes, that's correct. But there are two distinctions there. One is, if you're feeling pressured or agitated by what was happening, the decisions that you make in that state are going to be very different than if you engage yourself, you lower that pressure, you feel how you're influencing yourself, then a different array of choices or options might come to you.
So calming down first, in a sense, so that your brain, your it's not calming down. Feeling what you're feeling is a better way to say it.
That's right.
So that your higher brain is actually going to help make the decision rather than your reactive body.
Right.
Well, let's say it's more of your whole self in conversation together.
Aha, good.
Right. Now, that's a situational issue. Now, what about like the overall just tenor of the race for society, and how do you deal with that?
Yeah, absolutely.
See the difference I'm trying to make? I mean, there's a like the Rona example about sitting in a classroom and dealing with one person being racist, as opposed to just walking around on a day-to-day basis, walking down the street, going to a store, you know, driving, you know, and kind of worried about you know, any kind of thing that could happen on the road or being pulled over. How do I deal with that kind of stress?
Right, because you're on a sort of a high alert, in a sense.
Right.
Without even knowing it sometimes. Sometimes you're real aware of it, probably, and sometimes you're not.
Right.
Peter, any thoughts about that?
I mean, I know these are tough. I mean, I'm not...
Yeah, that's okay, but yeah. These are important questions, Rodney. I'm really glad you're asking them.
The challenge is, how do we start to develop a baseline of tolerance for our own responses in ourselves? So while engaging yourself won't necessarily remove all the challenges or remove the stress responses and the pressures that you feel, if it's possible to lower the baseline, then you have less effect from chronic stress.
Give me an example of what you mean by lowering the baseline.
Well, I'm imagining if Rodney's walking out the door through his neighborhood or anywhere about the city, feeling the oppression and beginning to become in some ways desensitized or immune to it, on one level makes things easier.
Yeah.
Physiologically, that may make things, you know, have a higher cost. So the challenge is, again, you know, greater participation and lowering the threshold of stress may make you more aware of it. But hopefully, right, in the process, that you will feel that you have more capability and more influence for how it affects you.
Because I have more control over my internal situation.
That's right.
And I think, you know, just we'll be taking other calls, but I think, Rodney, this is so important. And I think I just want to ask Peter one more question about this. So when we look at what helps people in terms of regulating and being in tune with their body, I would imagine this is, again, where someone who feels the oppression of racism on a regular basis, which we know exists on a regular basis, have to find ways to also, I think about people who work out or take a run or make sure they go off somewhere that's nice. I mean, are there other things to do that would add to that attunement of one being in touch with their own body?
Those certainly can add to the attunement.
Yeah.
The challenge is, are they distractions?
Uh-huh.
Or are they shifting the direction of attention from the outside world to the inside world? And hopefully in that process of moving back and forth in different ranges, which we all do, then you find relief where you can, and then you, again, start to lower that that baseline threshold of stress or pressure.
So you're not just internalizing everything that's going on, right? So that has the effect on your body. That's where your blood pressure goes up or your pulse goes up.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And not simply distracting yourself either.
Okay. Well, Rodney, thank you for opening up this questioning. And if you have any other question later on in the show, give us a call back.
Great. Thanks a lot for taking my call.
Okay. Bye-bye. Let's take another call now. We have... It's Regina from Sonoma, I think. Yes.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good. Thanks for calling, Regina.
Thank you. See, I almost forgot what I was going to ask, but just on what Rodney had said, this was not what I was going to ask, is I kind of feel it's difficult when you don't experience almost like being hunted on a daily basis.
Yes.
How to react. You never get off high alert. And because personally, I've been stalked for 30 years, and I never get off high alert.
Oh, I'm so sorry, but Regina. Yeah.
I am too. But here's what I'm asking. My question is, I have friends, extremely wealthy friends, that are always doing something. If they're not on a yacht, if they're not visiting and doing everything you can possibly do with all that money. And then when you see them, they say to you, what have you been doing? And I say to them, well, not much really. And it's sort of like you get the feeling like, oh, well, you don't have any value. Your life doesn't have any value. But I am doing things that they wouldn't engage in doing, like I'm an activist. You know, I do things. I work on the Bernie Sanders campaign and mm-hmm. stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But they are not interested in doing that. But to me, for a moment, it makes me feel like, oh, maybe I don't have much value. And then I think, well, no, I really have more value. But how in the hell do I tell these people that?
What a great question. And I realize that you've probably been around enough. You know, you don't sound like you're in your 20s. So I was going to say, you've been around.
No, I'm in my 70s.
Yeah, so you've been around enough to get to a place of really understanding your self-worth. You know, whereas even though it throws you off, there, you know, what you hear from them can be really off-putting. It sounds like you do know your worth. But let's see what Peter has to say. I think this Regina asks a great question here.
Yeah, hi, Regina.
Hi.
Some of the things that you might want to ask yourself in this situation are, where do you want to look to for your information? And why continue to engage those particular folks with a sense of your self-worth? And from the comments that you made, it sounds as though you're very clear about the things that you do that generate a sense of self-worth. But I'm wondering, mm-hmm. how do you give yourself that feedback? And how do you feel it? How do you feel when you're donating your time or you're extending yourself to others? What's that like for you?
Well, I just think it's a process of educating people that I'm doing. I mean, it's just being a teacher, not getting paid for it, you know, on political issues right now. Other issues in the past with other things, but right now politics is in the news and people are not well educated on the issues. So, yeah, I give my free time on that. And but I would like my friends who are bouncing all around the world to understand that they need to listen too. I mean, this is not
right. You would like to influence them rather having them have that effect on you. You'd like to influence them, and you know, sometimes we can and sometimes we can't. And I think the reality is you being who you are and you valuing what you do and you valuing the time you spend doing things that bring meaning to your life and joy to your life, that in itself is a teaching and a message. And they may see it, they may hear it, or they may not. Is that right, Peter?
It's the thing about learning. It's participatory. And so if they're not interested in that kind of learning, then how can you hold your sense of value for yourself?
Yes, that's right. And Regina, I think you're pretty wise, and you probably know at this point that you're probably not going to change those friends, but you never know. So it may be at some point, based on something you say or you do, someone wakes up a little bit and realizes that what you're doing is meaningful, or they may choose to live the life they continue to choose, right?
Well, that's fine. I don't mind them living their life. I think it's thrilling for them. But I guess what I could say is that I'm making a meaningful difference, I guess, for future generations. So what are you doing? I guess I could ask.
Or you could do that. Or you could just leave out the, so what are you doing? And then just leave it as a model. You're being a model for someone else. But no, it's great. And I hope you continue to grapple with this, because it's a great question, Regina. Thank you so much for calling us.
Thank you for listening. Thank you. Bye-bye.
You're listening to About Health. This is Nurse Rona, and I'm talking with Peter Wright. He's a somatic psychotherapist in the Bay Area, and you can call us at 1-800-598-9008. I'd like to talk a little bit, I think, about how somatic psychotherapy works and what you do with people and how it makes a difference.
Sure. So usually when somebody comes in to work, my general frame or orientation to that is they have reached a limitation in how they know themselves and what they can offer in terms of solutions for their life. But the biggest obstacle, you might not imagine, the biggest obstacle is not helping somebody go where they want to go in their life. Actually, the largest obstacle is helping them recognize where they're starting from. So as a somatic psychotherapist, the first orientation I help somebody generate is understanding who they are, how they have learned to hold themselves, how they have learned to act in their lives, and the relationship between their physical being and their sense of identity.
Give me an example of that.
Well, somebody could come in and say, well, my work life is no longer satisfying for me. And I've been doing the same thing for a long time. But as they describe it, I might help them recognize that there's a stiffness in their chest or that their jaw is starting to clench. And so what we begin to explore then is not necessarily the circumstances of their job, but the experience of their job as it's generated from the way that they're behaving or the way that they're acting. They may not recognize at all that they're stiff in their chest or that their jaw is tight. And once they begin to engage that, we can make a relationship then between that stiffness, that tightness, and how they experience themselves or how their friends experience them or coworkers or colleagues. And that, for example, that stiffness might mean there's not much availability for something new.
So they may come to you in part because of their job, but there may also be underneath that a sense of dissatisfaction with the level of well-being and joy in their life.
Which they may not know. And they may not know is in part related to the way they're engaging themselves.
And so the work you do, you continue, for you it's talking. Do you use hands-on with somatic therapy? What modalities do you use?
Mostly I engage people with questions about how they're living themselves physically and then helping educate them how to make a self-engagement. So attending to themselves, noticing and recognizing, which we'll practice in session, and then what they can do to make shifts so there's room for new possibilities. And so that might mean tensing their hands in relation to an overall level of tension in their body and then learning how to increase that and then decrease that. That's Stanley Kellerman's formative psychology called the how exercise. Really learning, how do you do you? How do you make the shapes of you?
How do I do me when I'm tense? And then
yes.
How do I do me when I let go?
Or when you're angry or sad and it's not to remove those emotions. They're all necessary and essential. But actually how to make distinctions in them or variations in them. And then you have different ranges of behavior.
So a lot of it is, another form of self-observation, mindfulness, but we're using the body as a real, what is it? It's a piece of information that we often ignore. This information that I know for me, like I might not notice that I'm picking at my nails.
Right.
Right? And it takes a certain kind of awareness to even notice what I'm doing when I'm tensing up.
That's right. And it's cultivated and it's to be engaged over time because if it's not, it atrophies like anything else. So again, if we circle back to the beginning with a kind of inundation of outside stimulus, phones, internet, etc., then we start to lose that kind of attending. Or paying attention to ourselves, we fall into routines and habits, and then we lose a kind of flexibility or malleability of self, and new possibilities aren't available.
And overall, that has an effect on our health and our well-being, and we don't even realize it a lot of the time. Let's take another call. We have Greg with us from Palo Alto. Hi, Greg.
Hello.
Hi.
Thank you. I have maybe a couple of questions. One, I think that
I'm probably one of many Americans who tend to lose sight experience their bodies fully. My guess is that if you went around talk to most people about a simple thing like breathing, they wouldn't be able to tell you that they were breathing. So I think we're pretty much all of us kind of out of our bodies to a certain extent or not. I wanted to get into the connection between, say, trauma and stress.
Oh, good. That was my next question. Thank you, Greg.
Okay. Well, I'm someone who not only has PTSD and have had it for years and unfortunately haven't had any successful treatment for it for a variety of reasons, but also lives in a very toxic environment stress-wise, which I should have gotten out of years ago. But the fact of the matter is that the stress just really aggravates the PTSD. It just re-traumatizes people. It certainly does to me. So I'm very interested in the somatic therapy. I'd like to hear more about that and more about that between the connection between stress and trauma, because I think that, once again, I just go back and say most of us have gone through our experiences with this, and here we are trying to cope the best we can, and some of us doing a better job than others.
Thank you for that. And again, that was what I was going to ask him. And I think just for make sure people know, PTSD is post-traumatic stress disorder. And thank you for your question, Greg. Peter?
Yeah, Greg, thank you for your question. I'm going to say something that might be unfamiliar or unusual for you, and that's to start by saying that trauma is a life-saving response. It really is. It's circumstances that generate huge physiological responses are the body's way of preserving itself. It's life-saving. But what it's not is identity-preserving. It's a life-saving response or a life-preserving response, but the response is so unusual, so unfamiliar, that it's outside of what we would consider our identity. Or in other words, it's not me. So if the response to an event is not outside of the familiar, we wouldn't say it's traumatic. We would say it's challenging or difficult. But once it reaches the intensity that it feels like the body is taking over, it's not something that we're doing consciously or intentionally, then people define it as trauma. But essentially the beginning is how important that response was there. It's wired into us. It's programmed over time in evolution for us to respond in particular ways.
I mean, it's a survival piece?
Absolutely, as a survival piece. But again, it's survival of an organism, but not a sense of personal identity. So the real challenge there is, and the work is, how to make a bridge between those two, between this life-preserving, enormous physiological response and the range of behaviors that we normally associate with, this is how I live myself, this is who I am.
And how do you make that bridge?
Gradually over time, with engaging those more traumatic behaviors at lower levels of intensity and going back and forth in those ranges so that there's enough of a bridge so that when, let's say, a clutching or what might feel a reactive response is on the way, that it feels it's something that you can engage, not something that you want to try to get away from, because there is no getting away from it.
Are you saying something like, people might say if you're afraid, don't try and just run away from that fear. You want to engage and kind of feel the fear or know what you're afraid about. Is that similar to what you're saying?
It is similar, but it's gradually building over time a way of relating to that response so it doesn't feel foreign. It doesn't feel like it's something that's taking you over.
Greg, you have a question related to what Peter's saying?
Yes, that makes sense to a certain extent, but I just want to add one thing. My personal experience, I've lived with the PTSD for over 20 years now, and I think for who knows what reasons, which would take too long to go into, I think, you know, at a certain level, I understand what he's saying and I can appreciate it, but when this becomes chronic and exists for a long period of time, whether it's a vet or somebody else has experienced this and it goes on and on without relief, then you start to see what I've been seeing over the past 5 years or so, and that is your health really starts
right.
to go down the drain.
Yes, that's
right.
The
body starts to fall apart.
Yeah, that stress that you've been experiencing for so long does have an effect, like we said, on your hormones, and you know, it could lead to all kinds of chronic illnesses. So I would, and I'd ask you, Peter, it's never too late to start.
Absolutely,
right.
It becomes more and more essential the longer it goes. What might offer something for you, Greg, is there is an impulse, and then there's our response to the impulse. And oftentimes those two are so close together that they're hard to distinguish. But you may recognize that the beginning of your PTSD symptoms also generate not just the impulse of that, but your response to it. And that's where you might be able to find some influence. Because if you can lower the magnitude of your response, the initial impulse becomes less of a threat. And I know that may sound like it's difficult to comprehend how to do that, and I wouldn't know how to work with you unless we were in the room together and I could see and you could describe to me what's going on. But if that's possible, some kind of influence is really the beginning of relief.
Are you talking like something like it might be breath work, for instance, or what kinds of things help in that? You can't make a generalization.
Well, it might be that beginning to feel an elevated blood pressure or shortening of breath, which then generates a kind of bracing as a response.
Mm.
And those two in concert start to reinforce each other.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get into that cycle for too long, then that becomes part of how you know yourself, and that becomes the familiar way of responding. So what we're really doing is trying to encourage another option, another possibility.
Can you think off the top of your head of any kinds of books that are helpful in that regard? I think about some of Peter Levine's work. I don't know if there's anything in particular that comes to mind.
Certainly Stanley Kellerman, Your Body Speaks Its Mind.
Mm-hmm.
Or same author, Somatic Reality. Those mm-hmm. are good places to start.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so much for your question, Greg. It's a hard one to answer, you know, again, on the radio in terms of the specifics, but hopefully there's a little food for thought there for you. And
okay, thanks.
I always appreciate your call.
Okay, thank you.
Let's take a call from Nancy now. You're on About Health, Nancy.
Thank you for this program and the topics you've been covering. And when I'm trying to think of his name, the man who called in about racism.
Yes, Rodney.
Rodney. Thank you. And what I was thinking about, and I also, being a former foster child, it turns out that foster children deal a lot with PTSD as well.
Yes.
And so it also relates with trauma, you know, specific traumas. But I was thinking about, like, when it's something really big like that, like racism, and I could hear what you were saying, but I had this feeling of frustration, and I realized it was because, you know, for one thing, it's not his fault, but he's the one who's having to monitor himself, and he's the one who's having to deal with the defensiveness. And what I realized is what's helped me is, and I've seen other people doing it as well, is to tune into our creative part of ourselves, because that allows us to give voice, and it gets to bring our whole selves into moving into some kind of a future of a positivity. where, I mean, any kind, whether it be drawing or writing or music or sculpting, you know, but anything that can give expression to what it is that we can see or feel about what this is that's troubling us, and some kind of a sense of ongoingness or future of our own goodness, that when we can put that into our creativity, it gives us an additional out, that if we avoid that and just go without that, then it's just us kind of against the world, and it's just too it's too hard that way.
You said it so beautifully, and I just want to ask you a brief personal question.
Sure.
Did you learn that wisdom when you were in foster care, or was it through your adult healing?
Whoa, boy, that's a good question. Yeah, oh my goodness. You know, I think a lot of me during the foster care experience was in numbers of ways frozen.
Yeah.
You know, I was just in stasis, in the shock of it, and just trying to be mindful of survival and awareness of trying to sort of do what my peers were doing, you know, even though I didn't have a family at home. But but there were still, like, I remember being in chorus, and that helped. And
singing, the voice.
Yes,
it's just an amazing healing modality.
And anything where we can see or feel or hear something where we are making a contribution into it. Later, yes, in my senior year, I was doing some writing. I remember my senior term paper, I felt a real sense of satisfaction, of accomplishment, of a creativity where I used my creative idea. So I wasn't just at the mercy of other people who couldn't care less about me, who were doing things with me and sometimes to me.
Yes.
And that's really good for my mental health when I can remember to do it.
It's just so beautiful. Peter, you want to respond to Nancy?
Yeah, Nancy, thank you. It's really wonderful to hear what you're saying. I guess the first thing I want to say is, the frozenness that you had in that situation?
Yes.
Good for you.
Thank you.
You preserved, you took care of yourself, and perhaps the only way that was possible, but you did. And that keeps that part of you that you're enjoying and living now, that kept it alive.
You're right. And I also wanted to thank you for introducing me to this idea that our trauma, it might even almost like be a friend.
Absolutely. That's a perfect way of saying it.
Yeah, that's very helpful. I'm going to think on that some more.
And the creativity that you're speaking of really speaks to self-agency.
Yep.
And self-influence, and that's exactly right. And I would just say, if you're interested, you could extend that sense of creativity to your own body. We're the sculptors of our own lives. And in a fascinating way, we are a sculpture that keeps sculpting itself from the time we're born until the time we die.
That's amazing.
Nancy, thank you so much. And thank you for picking up the phone and calling, because, you know, what you have to say lands, you know, on other people. And that's how I believe also we heal, is through telling our stories and to being generous with what we've learned, especially when you find the resilience. I listened to the program before us, The Space Between Us, The Space Between. I hadn't heard that program before. And it's also about telling stories and passing on our wisdom and our connection. So thank you, Nancy. Take good care.
Oh, thank you both.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
You're listening to About Health. I'm Nurse Rona. I'm talking with Peter Wright. The number is 1-800-958-9008. We still have a little time to take your call. Peter, while we're seeing if there's another call, why don't you talk a little bit about relationships and this? We're talking about the world we live in and the fast pace and how we're inundated by media and TV especially. There's so many things I haven't caught up with yet on Netflix and, you know, our computers, and we're dealing with the news of a world that makes a lot of us anxious. We're dealing with a president that a lot of us, you know, are uncomfortable with. But then we also have, we bring stress to our relationships, and that stress that we're dealing with individually has a great impact on whether we're listening to, connecting to, being in relationship with the people we love. Say a little bit about that.
Yeah, relationships are fascinating. Most of the couples that I work with, when they initially come in, they're very attentive to one another. So they'll be looking at each other, and often it will sound something like, well, if only you would do this, then I would feel better. And the fascinating thing about that is not only are they holding their partner responsible
yeah.
for their own well-being, but in that same act, they're giving away their own power or agency to influence themselves. So oftentimes couples come in feeling stuck, waiting for the other to change so that they can feel better. So by reorienting to, not dismissing what their partner does, because those things are important too, but reorienting to self-engagement, then the possibility of change is in your own hands. And that makes a huge difference.
So in a sense, you're saying, rather than, in a sense, complaining about what the other person's doing, you're asking the person to figure out, like, what they need, for instance?
Yes, but also when the other person is doing whatever they do, like, oh, he doesn't listen to me, or I keep saying the same thing again and again. Not only that dynamic, but also what happens inside them when their partner does that? Do they get upset? Do they get tight? Do they get tense? Do they start to feel like they're ready to collapse and feel hopeless? So these are the things they can begin to influence that offers another possibility in the pattern.
And how do they influence that? And what might it look like when someone does that? Give me a little concrete example of how they may then communicate differently with their partner.
Sure. So if for example, they're sitting in session with me and they're talking about a situation, let's say the partner that doesn't feel listened to starts to collapse, and then I could see that their shoulders start to go down, or they start to sag a bit in their chair, or their head goes down, then I can engage them about, okay, you're not only you're telling me about the situation, but you're reliving it in the telling of it, and that's something we can work with. So can you recognize that you're starting to collapse? And if you can feel how you're doing that, and if they can't, I'll point it out. I'll give them cues from what I see. If you can recognize that, how can you gather yourself rather than sag? You know, what's the familiarity of that? How do you know that about yourself? Well, that's what I do. That's what I grew up doing, or that's what I've learned to do. And then how can you just really simply engage gathering, pulling yourself up a bit,
and then
feeling what that's like, feeling what, now how could you respond from there? Because in a collapsed place, you might just give up or walk away. But in a more gathered and engaged place, you might say, hey, you know, I don't like it when you don't listen to me. So we're really trying to engage people with the possibility of change that they're capable of, not absent of wanting external change, but as augmenting and offering new possibilities.
And I think about people who are under a lot of stress, often the engagement in relationships also comes out in a form of anger.
It can, for sure.
I mean,
sure.
That's one of the irritability and anger that you see in couple relationships. So I would imagine that you have work to do there in terms of helping people understand something about the anger they're feeling.
Yes, and the ranges and what their anger offers. Sometimes it's good. Hey, I can't get through to this knucklehead, but I'm angry enough. Now it can happen. Or I'm angry all the time, and I feel a victim to my own anger. and how do I change that? And even though the circumstances, I might not be able to influence them as quickly as I like, if I can change it in myself, I have a say. Mm-hmm. And then I have some optimism.
You know, we have a few minutes left, Peter, and I realize that you have studied Aikido for 20 years, and I was just thinking about how you have found that relates to your own sense of stress and reducing stress and moving in the world and living in the world and understanding relationships. Can you say a little bit about that before we end?
Well, these days my Aikido practice is mostly with my three kids. And how I navigate bedtimes and getting ready for school and those kinds of things.
You move around them instead of head on.
You've got it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you understand a big dynamic of that.
Yeah.
But the connection has been very rich for me. So just in the simplicity of the example you gave, rather than move into it as in I'm going to change the circumstances to resolve what I'm feeling. Mm-hmm. If I can move around it, that takes a lot of self-engagement and self-agency. And then I'm in charge.
So like the power struggles that parents often face, you know, the head-on, not doing Aikido would be, I said do it now because I'm the mother and I told you to do this. Whereas Aikido might look like, it's time for bed. You want to pick out one story or two stories?
That's right, giving choice.
Giving some choice.
Yeah, or, let's think about you're saying no. What will that mean? And what's going to happen with you saying no?
Yes, I find that one of the questions we could do with a partner or with kids is always ask something like, wow, it looks like we have a problem here. Like, we have something to solve, and we need to talk about this together.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's a great way. So, a final word about stress and living in the world we live in.
Most of how we know ourselves is related to behaviors that we can see, things that we do on a large scale, going to work, the way we drive our cars, those kinds of things. But underneath those behaviors are the ways in which we orient ourselves in terms of pressure, in terms of range of motion and breath. Those kinds of things. And those are the dimensions that we practice again and again without recognizing it. So we could change our routines on a larger scale of behavior, but not change those smaller ones. And those we continue to practice again and again. So if we can give some time to those things, some time to how much room I give myself when I breathe, how much tension I'm holding, even how I'm getting out of bed to begin my day. Give yourself 20 extra seconds lying in bed and feel, okay, what do I want to make the baseline of how I move through the day? That can offer a lot.
And eating lunch. Do I actually stop and eat somewhere else, or am I eating at my desk and tensing up at the computer while I eat?
That's right.
So many things like that. Well, Peter, I thank you so much for joining us today. I really appreciate your work here in the Bay Area, and I will pay much more attention to how I'm picking at my nails and what I'm doing right now. Thank you, and thank you to my listeners. I also want to thank our board operator, Erica Bridgman. I'll be back next week talking to Bay Area comedian and treasure Josh Kornbluth. We're going to talk about aging, memory, and dementia. But in the meantime, you can reach me at my website at nurserona.com. Sending my best to my regular listener, James Anderson. James, take good care. And thank you all. May you be healthy, happy, and live with some ease and peace.
Are you wanting support to resolve conflicts in your life?
Do you wish you were better at creating a peaceful and just world?
On Talk It Out Radio, Sundays from 7 to 8 p.m., we offer the skills of self-compassion,
effective communication,
and creating understanding across differences.
Come listen, call in, and practice with us.
Talk It Out.
Talk It Out.
Talk It Out Radio, Sundays, 7 to 8 p.m. on KPFA.
South Bay Contra invites you to our monthly Contra Dance featuring the live fiddle tunes of String Fire Band and Calling by Gene Gibson Corindo from Los Osos. The Contra Dance takes place from 2:30 to 6 p.m. on Sunday, July 16th at First Unitarian Church of San Jose, 160 North 3rd Street, San Jose. No experience or partner needed, and all ages are welcome. This event is wheelchair accessible and is a benefit for Bay Area Country Dance Society and First Unitarian Church of San Jose. For more information, call 408-341-9123 or www.bacds.org/SBC. No experience or partner needed, and all ages are welcome.